feet. For the next few minutes, Lord, we just want to focus on you. Thank you, Lord, for who you are. Shine through all the praises that we sing for you. Are the one we want to meet, Jesus. Shine through. The praises said we sing. Come and let your presence.
Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. We welcome you. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place
for you.
For you are the one we want to meet. Jesus, shine through all the praises that we sing, we have come to give you highest praise, we have come to love you in this, it's why we came, Lord. We have come to love you in this praise, highest praise. We have come to love you in this place. We have come to give you highest praise, highest praise. We have come to love you in this place. For you are the one we want to meet. Jesus, shine through all the praises that we sing. It's all for you. It's all for you. Here we are, here we are. It's all for you. Here we are, here we are. It's all. Your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place, Jesus. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Come and let your presence fill this place, Jesus. Come and let your presence fill this place.
This is a new song we're going to learn together. This is holy moment. Try that with me. This is a holy moment. This is a holy moment. This is a holy moment. Let's try the chorus together. It goes like this. Come with expectation, everything abandon. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. Let's go back to the top. Holy moment. This is a 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 holy moment. Yeah. So come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. Sing it again. Yeah, come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Our anthem, celebrate the wonder of His love. He is here. He is here with us now.
He is here.
He is here with us now. He is here. He is here with us now. Yes, He is. He is here with us now. Oh, so come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His come with them. So come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. He is here. He is here with us now. Yes, He is. He is here with us now.
Jesus is here.
is here.
He is here with us now.
Yes, He is.
He is here with us now. Oh, so come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Oh, lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. Come, so come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love.
For your honor.
For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up as we overflow with praise. For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up with your overflow with praise. For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up as we overflow with praise. For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up as we overflow with praise. So come with expectation, everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. Oh, come with expectation, everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love.
This is a holy moment. Oh, yes, God. This is a holy moment. This is a holy moment. This is holy moment. He is here with us now. He is here with us now. Yes, He is.
He is here with us now.
He's here.
He is here with us now. He is here with us now. Oh, so come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. Oh, come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love.
Holy moment.
This is holy moment. This is a holy moment. This is a holy. Thank you.
change, you are near. In every sorrow, you are my strength, you are near. A peace in the storm, your voice I will follow. In weakness I rise, remembering you hold my world. I'm holding on to hope, I'm holding on to grace, I'm fully
Redeemer.
My great Redeemer, my constant friend, you are near. My faithful Father, you took me in, you are near. A peace in the storm, your voice I will follow. In weakness I rise, remembering you hold my world. I'm holding on to hope, I'm holding on to grace, I'm fully letting go.
Oh, how I love you.
Thank you.
today I need you, Lord. Yes, God. More than words can say, I need you, Lord. Than ever before, I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. You, Lord, yeah. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
The creator of the universe works toward a greater purpose in ways that are sometimes beyond our understanding. According to Isaiah 55, the Lord said the following: "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Yet he chases us, he chases after us for a one-on-one relationship with him. And although he hates sin, he has demonstrated unending love for each one of us, according to Psalm 103. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. And although it doesn't make rational sense, he unselfishly gave up his son for us, as foretold in Isaiah 53. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Certainly his ways are higher than our ways, and he alone is worthy of our honor, our praise, our worship. For he chose to give us the greatest gift of all, which is our eternal salvation. He is mighty to save." Let's continue our worship with our offering.
If the ushers come forward, we're going to pray. Father, I just thank you for this place, for the truth that is spoken here. We can't outgive you. You've given so much. And you continue just to pour out on us and work all things in our life. Who else is there, Lord? Who else is there to serve? We will serve somebody. We choose you, God. You chose us, and we say yes and amen. So today we give to the best of our abilities from our finances. I ask that you would bless everyone here, Lord, that just whether in abundance or in lack, they give. And you love all of it because you want our heart. You want us to trust you with all of it. So Father, for everyone here, for every family member represented here, for everyone that prays, for every prayer that's prayed, from these people, from us, Lord, would you come and would you just move your kingdom, just just drive your kingdom into our families, into our finances, into our neighborhoods, into our cities, Lord. Yes. We want to see your kingdom come here in Marietta, in the Marietta Vineyard. Lord. We want to see you come and do mighty things here today. Start today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This is holy moment. This is holy moment. This is holy moment. This is holy moment. Come with expectation. Come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. He is here with us now. He is here with us now. He is here with us now. Oh, we're declaring that. Yeah. He is here with us now. Oh, so come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His come. Oh, come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. For your honor. For your honor and fame. Fall again in this place. Fill us up with and we overflow with praise. For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up as we overflow with praise. For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up as we overflow with praise. For your honor and fame, fall again in this place. Fill us up as we overflow. With praise. So come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Yeah, lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. One more time. Come with expectation. Everything abandoned. Look and see the glory of our God. Yeah. Lift your voice to heaven. Jesus is our anthem. Celebrate the wonder of His love. This is a holy moment. 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 Give the Lord a praise offering, saints.
To all those who are visiting, and thanks for representing. Reet.
That's
have to see if we had any hunters in here that have some hand. This week we have a few announcements.
Up here more. Okay. What's that movie that's out now? I Am Your Father. One Harvest.
One Harvest. The food box orders are due this Wednesday at midnight. Okay, so please see Dusty and Sally and check the menu at the connection table for some good discounted food. Our pantry that we have, that we give out a lot of food to the local folks, it needs replenishing. So please consider what you can do. Grab a brown bag by the exit, the front door's there. Take it, fill it up with what the items are that we have listed there, and then bring it back when you come back. And we thank you very much for helping those folks in need in our area. Worship weekend's coming up. You cheer now, just wait. Friday, January 22nd and Saturday, January 23rd at 7 p.m. We're gonna have Kent Henry. He'll be here both those nights at 7 p.m. and then again on Sunday morning at worship at 10:30. So join us as we seek God's face together. The cafe, the one that we all enjoy out here every Sunday, it needs new volunteers. Now, we have a lot of people here that volunteer for everything every week or whatever they can. We're looking for new volunteers or people who haven't volunteered in a while. Need some new blood, some fresh faces in there. And it doesn't hurt. It really, it's not painful. And you just come in an hour early on Sundays and you get to help out in there. And, you know, you get to see what it is that you're putting out before it's put out. It's only 1 hour before service. So looking for some more help around here. We appreciate everything everybody's been doing. And we continue to give you thanks and the Lord thanks for everything he's giving us. That's all that's on the list.
Hey, thank you, Walker. I wanted to reiterate before we dismiss the kids that on the worship weekend, if you've never, some of you may not know who Kent Henry is. Kent Henry's been leading worship for almost 40 years, and he's been with Integrity Hosanna, he's been in Maranatha, he's been part of the Vineyard and done things, and there's guys that lead worship, guys and gals that lead worship, then there's guys and gals that live worship, and Kent Henry is a 62-year-old guy with white hair, talks like a surfer, and he lives on Jupiter, okay? I'm serious. I mean, he's out there. And his whole life has been dedicated to worship. I've been privileged to be in several meetings that he's led over the last 30, 40 years. And it's like nothing you've ever gone to before. And some people are shaking their heads because they know who I'm talking about. So don't miss it. Will there be childcare? As of right now, no. But we're looking to maybe let that happen. But Kent is all about having the kids in there. It does not disturb Kent at all, because nothing disturbs Kent, okay? He's out, and he called me the other day to talk. He goes, bro! And I went, yeah, exactly. And I said, hey, Kent. He goes, oh, dude, man. Oh, bro, I'm coming down there to mess you guys up, man. And I go, well, we're going to mess you up too. Because, oh, bring it, bro. Bring it, man. Praise God. Okay, I got to go. No, Kim, what do you want to tell me? Oh, yeah, bro. And he's there's people, then there's Kent Henry. So make sure you come. Friday night's going to be 7 to, there's no end time. It's a come and go. But you'll get stuck, promise you. And that's going to be worship and intercession. And then Saturday morning, those are on the worship team. And if you want to just come to that, you're more than welcome to. He's going to be talking to the worship team about worship and stuff, that those that can make it. It's not mandatory, but I encourage you to come. And then Saturday night, it starts at 6. Starts at 6, and that's worship and soaking. Okay, if you've never been in soaking before, get ready. You're going to get messed up. Okay? So, and then Sunday morning, he's going to bring the word and also lead worship. So don't miss that, okay? There was one other thing I wanted to tell you, and I can't remember what it was, so I guess it wasn't important. So, children, be free. Go to your classes. Rest of you, fellowship for just a moment, okay? All righty. For those of you that are still here and that are going to be in here, let's round up and find a spot.
Hello, hello.
Yep, there you go. This morning we are honored. We are honored to have Rick Coffin. He's going to speak to us and minister to us this morning through the Word. So I encourage you all to put on your, sounds like school, put on your listening ears and listening heart. And, come on, buddy, let's pray for you. I love this man. Love this man.
Me too, buddy.
Father, I pray that you bless this time, and I know you will. May your kingdom come and your will be done in this moment. May it be a holy moment as we open your word, as we hear what you laid upon Rick's heart. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Got a little surprise here for a little bit later. Hope it's not too distracting. It's good to be here this morning. Some of you know, perhaps most of you, that about 25 years ago, along with some friends, I helped plant the Marietta Vineyard and then pastored it for, I think, 13 years. So it is always very special to be here. And last couple years, my wife and I have been living in India for 10 years, 5 years in Delhi and 5 years in Bangalore, and I'm just learning how to do my notes from my computer, so you're going to have to put up with me. And I just realized I actually need to open it up to the right place. There. Sorry about that. I have no idea what I was saying before I interrupted myself. Yes, I was in India, that's right. my brain is in India. Yeah, so for 10 years, Ellen and I have been living in Delhi, 5 years in Delhi and then 5 years in Bangalore. And we have been helping to plant a church there. And hey, can I get you to turn this down a little bit? Yeah, that'd be great. Then I could get excited and not like blow everybody out because I'm having to talk a little soft. Thank you. So, last 10 years, we've been living in India. My wife's not here today, and I apologize for that. She misses getting to be here. She's visiting our son. We have a son who lives in Washington, D.C., and is getting married in about 6 months, so we're excited about that, or 9 months, I guess. And we have a daughter who's married and lives in Chicago, and we have a little grandson. And one thing I've learned about grandfathers is that every grandfather I know has pictures on their phone or in their wallet of their grandson. So if you want to see pictures, I'd love to show you. I have lots of grandfather stories. It's great being a grandfather. I really, really love that. I was having lunch with Ron at my favorite barbecue place, which we can go to anytime, buddy. I love barbecue. Don't get barbecue like that in India. So we were at the barbecue place, Dreamland. If you like Dreamland, it's great barbecue. And Ron was sharing with me that God's been speaking to him about just some different aspects of vision for the church and he was sharing that, and it was just so exciting to hear what God has put in his heart. And our prayers are with you guys, that God would do everything that God has been speaking, and that he would bless this place. And part of what Ron was saying was just that God, he feels like God's stirring in him, that this would be a place of encountering God. And as he shared that with me, I was thinking about my own life. My wife and I, the last year has been a very challenging year for us. We, about a year ago, Lord spoke to me that it was time for us to turn the church over in Bangalore. And that had been our goal the whole time we were there, is to raise up leadership and turn the church over to them. But the thing about this that was particularly challenging is that the elders that are there are doing a great job, but they did not want to pastor the church. And I felt like God said that it was time to turn the church over to them, kind of like, ready or not, here it is. And so that instantly just stirred up, of course, some anxiety, but also just, oh God, you know, prepare them. You know, if this is you, it's going to be really good. If it's not you, this could like crash and burn really easily. And so it just stirred in our own hearts recognition that we needed times of prayer, and we needed God to intervene. And out of that desperation, this last year has been for us a time of growing in prayer and seeking to have those special encounters with God in prayer and crying out to Him about specific things. About 3 or 4 months after God spoke that to me, we found out that our English Institute was being investigated by the local authorities, and that it looked like it was possible that we would be evicted from the country. And lots of our friends, the government situation in India has changed, and lots of our friends we started hearing stories regularly of friends that maybe would go out of the country for a visa run and then come back and not be allowed back in at the airport, things like that. So again, it was like, oh God, we need you. You know, this is our life, and this is our heart, and, you know. So through all of that, we've been learning more about prayer and encountering God in prayer. And I want to just share a little bit with you today, specifically from the book of Luke, about encountering God in prayer. And, you know, more than any of the other Gospels, all the Gospels talk about the prayer life of Jesus, but more than any of the other Gospels, Luke chooses to really emphasize one of the themes that he has are the times in which Jesus spends time in prayer. On 9 different occasions, Luke talks about Jesus and his prayer life, not just teaching about prayer. That's in addition. There's additional times when Jesus is teaching about prayer, but I mean 9 different occasions where he himself is praying about different things. And it's so valuable to look at those. I wish we had time to go through all 9 of them. We don't, but we'll look at several of them. But one of the first things that as we look at those 9 events, one of the things that really stands out to me is just how important prayer was to Jesus. And the life and the ministry of Jesus were anchored by these encounters. And certainly these weren't the only, these are just representative of what was a lifestyle of Jesus. And by looking at these different encounters, we can see, sorry, my computer's acting weird here. By looking at these encounters, it tells us a lot about the importance of prayer in the life of Jesus, but not only in the life of Jesus, but also for us. For example, in Luke chapter 5, I believe we have a slide for that. Luke chapter 5 tells the story of, part of the story of the 5th chapter is that Jesus heals the man born with, or that had leprosy. And it's a great story. This leper, like anybody with a disease, is desperate. And he comes to Jesus, and he falls down before Jesus, and basically he begs him and says, if you are willing, you can heal me. And Jesus, full of compassion, reaches out and touches this man, something that probably nobody had done for years since he had leprosy, touches him and says, I am willing, be healed. And instantly this man is healed. And you can imagine the kind of commotion that would have brought from the community. And so from that point on, it says that crowds were pressing in on Jesus and constantly trying to be near him and to be to touch him and to be healed by him. But then in verse 16 of chapter 5, it says, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Jesus relied on these times of interaction with God to keep a sense of peace in the midst of the turmoil, the chaos, the pressing of individuals that were coming at him. And they all had an agenda for his life. But Jesus relied on these times of pulling away to have a sense of what God was really calling him to do. And oftentimes, after these occasions of pulling away, people would say, hey, come and do this. And he was like, no, that's not what I'm called to. This is what I'm called to. And it was like, oh, wow, why aren't you doing this? It was because he had spent time in God's presence. And we live in a day when we are surrounded by so much going on in our lives. So much is bombarding us, so many ideas, so many suggestions. Our culture presses in on us, media, all these different things. And our lives are jam-packed with stuff, right? All of us. But prayer is so important in order to pull away and have an encounter with God to gain perspective on what he wants us to do. In Luke chapter 6, it tells the story of Jesus making one of the most important decisions up until that point of his ministry. You know, all of us, I look at my life and, you know, I can look back. I'm almost 60 now, and as you get a little bit older, you know, you start to look back and you can see the different decisions you've made in life and the impact that they have. And there's a handful of decisions that have a huge impact. And as I look back, I recognize, you know, some of those decisions were really good and some of them were really bad. You know, I've made a lot of all of those kinds of decisions. And I just recognize how important it is to be led by God when we make decisions. The way Jesus did that was that he went away, it says in the 6th chapter of Luke, and he spent all night praying about the individuals that he was going to spend the next 3 years with. You know, here are these crowds. Everybody's pressing. His life is jam-packed. But Jesus knows that what's coming is the cross. And dying for our salvation, of course, was his ultimate purpose. But he also needs to leave behind individuals who know him and understand his mission, who carry on the work that he's doing and can spread the message to the nations. Who are those individuals going to be? Jesus decided, the 12 that night, spending a whole night in prayer. Jesus relied on the encounters with God, the times of prayer, to help him make the important decisions of his life. And I'm sure it wasn't just this decision. This is just representative. This was how Jesus went about making decisions. In Luke chapter 9, we have another really interesting occasion. You know, when we think about Jesus, one of the most important things is that the disciples come to the realization of who he is. And not only who he is, but what his purpose is and what he's going to do, his work on the cross, right? Well, on one occasion, again, when Jesus is pulled away and he's praying, he spends time with his disciples. And he's been praying. And I believe that what was happening in that time of prayer is that Jesus was coming to a place of partnership with the Father. You know, it says in John chapter 5, Jesus says, I only do those things that I see my Father doing. That comes out of his prayer life. So I think this is one of those occasions. Jesus is with the Father, and he's saying, Father, you know, I don't know if they get it. I don't know if they know who I am. How should I approach this? Now, that's my estimation of what must have happened in his prayer life. I don't know exactly what he said. But in that prayer, Jesus comes out of that prayer time, and he doesn't give a lecture. He doesn't do a Bible study. He asks a question. Who do the crowds say that I am? And the disciples say, well, some say you're John the Baptist, you know, or one of the prophets of old, or, you know, they don't really know. Well, who do you say that I am? And Peter makes that great declaration. You are the Christ, the Messiah of God, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you. Flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. You didn't just figure this out, Peter, because you're a really smart fisherman. But my Father has revealed this to you. Now think about that. That's the kind of partnership that you and I want when we think about any kind of ministry. We can't heal the sick. We can't, you know, we can't lead our neighbors to Christ, or, you know, by ourselves. We can't do so many things in ministry that we want to do. It's going to need to be a partnership with the Father. And that happened in the life of Jesus in prayer. Father, how should I talk to them about this? How should I approach this? He asks a question, and then the Father speaks to Peter. There's a part that we play, and there's a part the Father plays, right? That's the partnership in ministry. And that was born out of an encounter of prayer. The last one that stands out to me is in the 22nd chapter of Luke. It tells the story of Jesus. It says that he, after the time in the upper room with the disciples, it says that he went to the Garden of Gethsemane. And it says that he went there regularly. This was his habit, to go up on the Mount of Olives, to be away, to be in a quiet place, a garden. And he went there, and while he was there, he processed his own emotions. Remember, Jesus is fully God, but he's also fully man. And as he's facing the cross, he has to do business with the Father. He has to work through this exceptionally difficult thing in which he has to surrender to the Father's will. And we're allowed to, you know, Jesus, you know, kind of the curtains pulled back, and we get to see a little bit of his prayer life and the interaction. And it's so significant for us, because every one of us has things that are hard in our life, things that aren't what we would choose, things that we think, you know, God, I'd really rather you did something different in this situation. A lot of times, I know the family I grew up in, we just didn't talk about those things, and we didn't think about them either, really, more than we needed to. It's just like, let's just ignore the elephant in the room. But Jesus showed us how to really work through those things and do business with God. And it happened in an encounter prayer. So I'm really determined to learn more about prayer. I don't feel very good at it. I have, like you, I'm sure, a long list of things I've been praying for. And some of those have been answered the way I would really like. and many of them haven't. But I'm determined as I move forward, I want to learn more about prayer. And I want to have more of these encounters that help me to make good decisions, that help me to partner with God. And I think that's what we all want. And prayer is really a key for that. And I want to look further at two passages that I think, I got a lot to work out on this computer thing. I keep having to put my password in every time I go back to open up the page. And then as soon as I do that, it tells me about the internet that I could sign on to. And then finally I get back to, I guess I need to disable all that stuff, right? Anyway, I need a computer person to help me know what to do. Anyway, okay, sorry about that. Are you excited about learning what the water's all about up here? We need to take a vote and see what you guys think it is. Somebody thought it was water from the Ganges or something. I don't know. Mostly it's from Rick and Becky's backyard. And I'm not going to drink it. But let's look at two more passages. And Jesse, we can turn to the Luke 3. In the third chapter of Luke, this is, again, one of the nine passages that talks about prayer. Let's read that together. It says this: when all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven: you are my son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased. Now, right off the bat, we need to acknowledge that this is a unique experience in the life of the Son of God. Okay. So there's some aspects of this that are unique to Jesus, and Jesus is unique. And Jesus had a unique relationship with the Father. But a number of years ago in prayer, I was working through some of my own issues of struggling with some insecurity and just some different challenges. And in prayer, I heard the Lord say, "You are my son." He reminded me of this passage. You are my son, and I'm pleased with you. And I realized as I heard those verses, it's like, no, that's what you said to Jesus. But I recognized, you know, we are God's children. One of the amazing things about salvation is that we have been adopted into the family of God. How great is the love of the Father that we should be called the children of God. What an amazing thing. And so I think that we need to recognize, even though this is a unique experience in the life of Jesus, and Jesus is fully God and fully man, and heaven and earth meet in Christ, even though that's unique, that's the heart of God for every one of us. It's God's desire that heaven and earth would meet in our lives, in our prayer life. And so here where Jesus is praying, the characteristic of his prayer is that the heavens open. Now, on that occasion, it doesn't tell us exactly what that meant. So we don't know, you know. It could be that everybody around also suddenly were able to look into some aspect of heaven. I don't know. I don't know what it means fully. Nobody does. But what we do know is that somehow heaven and earth intersected in some way where the barriers between heaven and earth were removed at that moment. And I believe that's God's desire for that to characterize our prayer as well. You know, Acts 17 says that Jesus or I'm sorry, Peter, Paul. I won't change it again, I promise. Paul is in Athens, and he says that he's talking to a group of atheists, a group of people that don't know God. And he says, you know, the time of your birth, the date of your birth, and the location where you were born was determined by the Creator. And he has been active in your life more than you realize. And he has done this with a desire that you would reach out and find him, even though he's not far from any of us. It's an amazing passage. The idea is that, you know, we think of heaven as far off somewhere, God's living way out there, distant. But what Paul says is that, no, actually, God's presence is within arm's reach. He's right here, close by. And so I believe one of the characteristics of Jesus' prayer and one of the characteristics that should characterize our prayer is that as we draw near to him, we encounter him. Now, I have found that in order to experience that, even in a small measure, it's really important for me to get away. That's why I think it's so important that Jesus kept talking, you know, these passages in Luke and the other Gospels talk about Jesus getting away. And, you know, we have lots of, you know, we have lots of distractions. I don't know how else to say it. But we have to turn our phone off. I found it's really hard for me to do my devotions with my computer right here, because social media and the news and my email are so accessible. I need to get away. And I need to find a place where it's just me and God, and I don't have other distractions, and I was ADD before they had the name adopted, I'm pretty sure, at least to some measure, and I need to just get away and be quiet. Here's what I want you to do. We're going to do a little practice. I want you to close your eyes in a minute, not yet, for, let's say, 30 seconds. And I just want you to be still and quiet in the presence of God and don't think about anything else. Just be in God's presence and enjoy his love for you. Okay? Let's do that right now. Everybody close your eyes. And let's just be quiet for 1 minute. Amen. All right. What did you experience? Anything? Just what happened? Anybody close your eyes and remember last night's Star Wars movie you watched? I mean, those scenes are pretty powerful. I went to see that last night. It's a cool movie. Sorry, is that kind of a nerdy thing to say? Anyway, I liked it. What happened when you... Anybody have trouble just not thinking about other things? How many of you had trouble not thinking about other things for 1 minute? Yeah, it's hard. We have so many things bombarding our mind. That's what this is about. It's pretty gross looking. It's supposed to be clear, but it's pretty clear right now. But think of it like this. Okay, that's how it was. Why was it so clear before? Everything's settled. That's right. The same thing has to happen in our lives. This is how we live our lives mostly, like that. That's how I live my life. And so in the midst of that, when I come to God in prayer, it doesn't feel like heaven's real close. It's really hard for me. You know, I'll open the scripture and I'll start to read a little bit, and the next thing you know, I'm thinking about a problem with our finances, you know? And I go a little bit further, and maybe I start to pray, and I pray the first sentence or two, and next thing you know, I'm thinking about, you know, oh, I got an appointment this afternoon. You know? And that's all this stuff in our lives. But it'll take that another half hour to cool down, you know, for the dirt to settle, like you said. And now, you know, we don't always have 30 minutes, but I'll tell you this. One thing I found is there's some things I have some control over. Okay, no, I'm not going to look at email before I pray in the morning. I'm not going to read the news. I'm not going to, you know, there's some things. I'm going to use my Bible instead of looking at the Bible on the internet because that's too much temptation. So there's some things I have some control over. Some things, it just takes some time to settle, even the stuff that's already there. But the more you do this, just that little simple exercise that we just did, the more you do that consistently, things will start to settle. And you'll start to learn how to quiet yourself in God's presence. And I think that was a part of Jesus' experience. And what characterizes his prayer time was not only the closeness, you know, heaven and earth coming together. It was also when he experienced that, it says the Holy Spirit descended on him. And then what happened? Holy Spirit came upon him, and then what happened? It's not a rhetorical question. Pardon? God spoke to him. What's supposed to characterize our prayer time is that as we quiet ourselves, as we get away, the barriers between us and the Father start, that gets thinner. And then we start to experience the presence of the Holy Spirit. God's with us. Like, oh, he's here. You know, we can sense him. Sometimes very intensely, sometimes just faintly, sometimes by faith, we just believe that, okay, I'm in the presence of God. And then we begin to pray, but we also listen. And it's in times like that that the Father speaks to us. Now, I wish I could say this happens every day for me. It doesn't. I want it to happen more often. But I believe for every one of us, it is something that God wants to do. And every single one of us can have these kind of encounters with God where we sense that closeness. We experience the presence of the Holy Spirit and we hear God's voice. In the fourth chapter of Luke, the next chapter, we read this. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized. I'm sorry, reading the same verse. Sorry, that's chapter 3. Here's chapter 4. Chapter 4. After this occasion, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. When I've thought of this passage in the past, I think I always was thinking, okay, Jesus, the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted. That's what it says, right? So in my mind, I was kind of thinking, you know, like, okay, the Holy Spirit, God spoke to Jesus. Okay, next thing we're going to do is we're going to go out into the wilderness, and you and Satan are going to have it out, and everybody's going to see that you're not going to give in to this temptation. I don't think that's what happened. The more I thought about this passage, I don't think Jesus went into the wilderness to meet the devil. I think Jesus went into the wilderness to be with God. He wasn't like, come on, let me at him, you know. I think that was just, that was secondary. His focus was to be with the Father. He went to be with the Father. That's what he always did. And while he was with the Father, it's very clear what he was doing. Tell me, what is it that happened that we know about that took place during those 40 days? What took place? He got hungry. What else? I didn't read the rest, but you know the story. Tell me what happened. Pardon? Okay, Satan came and tempted him, offered, you know, you can have this, just do that, and why don't you do this? Why don't you turn the bread, the stones into bread? And you know the temptations, right? So he was tempted by God. How did Jesus respond? Somebody? He quoted scripture. Yeah. Anybody know where the scriptures are from? Yeah, well, okay, but what book of the Bible? Deuteronomy. Every single one of them. You know what I think Jesus was doing in the wilderness? The other 39 and three-fourths of a day, you know? Those temptations didn't necessarily take the full 40 days. I think Jesus was meditating on the scriptures. He was praying about the Bible. Now, this is really critical for us. You know, they didn't have, you know, a nice leather-bound NIV. He wasn't carrying that into the wilderness. They had passages that they would memorize. And Jesus probably had the book of much of, if not all of, the book of Deuteronomy memorized. They memorized a lot of scripture. And while he was in the wilderness, he was praying about those passages. And the Holy Spirit was prompting, you know, bringing to his attention certain scriptures. I'm convinced that's what Jesus was doing in the wilderness. And then when the enemy came, they were right there at hand. Now, the interesting thing about that is he's not just quoting scripture. It's not just when I was a kid, NIV, or not NIV, Navigators had a lot of these scripture cards, and you would kind of go through them and memorize. It was really good. But the neat thing about that is that it wasn't just rote scripture. What happens is when you memorize scripture, they're in your heart, and then in your conversations with God, you can start to talk about these scriptures. What's the significance of this scripture? You know, Jesus said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. I think Jesus was meditating on that, praying about it. When we say meditate, we think of something kind of an Eastern type thing. But the key here, I think, is that he prayed about the scriptures. And he prayed, I'm sure, what's the significance of this scripture? And he thought about it. And he was dwelling on the word. And then, as he did that and was praying in this encounter, this time of closeness with God and the presence of the Holy Spirit, God would speak to him, the Father. What's most important in your life is not sustaining yourself physically, but hearing my voice and living your life on my voice. Father, I love your voice. See, there's the word, the written word, but then there's what God's saying in and through the word that needs to become part of our lives. And that happened in Jesus' life, and it can happen in our life when we pray through the scriptures. So we need to read and study the scriptures, definitely, but we also need to say, God, as I read through this passage, is there something specific in this passage you want to speak to me about? And you'll sense, it may just be just a little whisper. It may, I'm not talking about an audible voice or anything. It may just be, I feel drawn to this part. A few years ago, let me give this example. Yesterday, I was reading Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 5, talks about how we were dead in our sin. But God, who is rich in mercy, his amazing mercy, because he loves us, he made us alive in Christ. And I just felt drawn to those words, just thinking about God's amazing mercy. And so I just spent some time just dwelling on that. Okay? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to do the same thing, and we'll close with this. I want you to think about the first words of Psalm 23. Anybody know Psalm 23? First couple. How's Psalm 23 start off? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Okay? Here's what I want you to do. I just want you to think about that verse, just that one verse, and just kind of repeat it to yourself, go over it, and then just say, God, is there any part of this that you want to speak to me about? And then just listen. Let him speak to you about his word and to make it real to you. Okay? So let's close our eyes again, and I want you to think about that verse and pray about it. Amen. Amen. You know, as soon as I closed my eyes and started praying, I sensed the Lord saying to me, the Lord is my shepherd. It's something I hadn't thought of before. I just realized it's one thing to have a warm, pastoral shepherd. You know, oh, nice sheep, I care for you. But I just sensed the Lord saying, I am the Lord. And as the Lord, I am your shepherd. And I just felt like God was reminding me of some things that sovereignly he's done that have really blessed Ellen and I this last couple months, and just some awesome answers to prayer. And I just was able to say, Lord, you are my shepherd, and you are Lord. You are able to do exceedingly abundantly, you know, that whole thing. Somebody else, what stirred? We only took a minute or two, but something in that verse that you felt drawn to? How did that make you feel? Was that like a new thought for you?
It's all, yeah, it's, for yeah. me it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I yeah. Of yeah. Of, yeah. Of, yeah. This
yeah.
Yeah. Said, no, that's,
yeah.
Really
yeah. 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 Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Feels pretty good to have that assurance. Yeah, from the Lord. You know, now you won't read that. Nobody writes that in a book or anything, but within what God was saying to David, God was able to meet Anthony, is that right? Anthony. Meet Anthony and speak to him from that passage, and he will do that in all of our lives. Amen? Let's all stand. This week, I encourage you, in addition to whatever else you've been doing, and you may already be doing something very similar to this, add to that a little more time away and have an encounter with Christ, with the Father, with the Holy Spirit in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We're so thankful that you're not far away. We thank you that you sent your Son for us, and that you have adopted us into your family, and that we are the children of God. We are your children. We're your sons and daughters. And we need that, Lord. We need you. You are our life and our breath. I pray for all of us, Lord, that we would be able to get away more, and that we would be able to draw near to you, to experience you, to hear your voice as we spend time in your word. We'd hear what you're saying to us, and that it would give life to us and to others, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord bless you. On.